Thank you. It is so good to have you join with us again at the same time each week. And again, we count it our privilege to have you follow along in our Bible studies. Wonderful to hear the letters and to read the letters that we get from the listeners out there. And they're increasing. But we're always glad to hear from you. And we hope that you will, in your busy schedule, take time to write us if you listen to the broadcast and give us your comments. And if you have any questions, write them. We'll do the best we can to answer them for you. We're now considering here and continuing on here with Adam and Eve, the first mention of the blood back here, which is a first mention principle which carries all the way through the Bible. We find out that where the blood is mentioned, it carries all the way through to your salvation today, which pointed to the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, where his precious blood was shed, the substitute of another, to pay for my sins and yours, that we could be passed from death unto life. So we want to take here and examine this, and to do this, we have some additional information that's given to us here in 1 Timothy chapter 2, in verse 14 and 15. So let's read here, and then we'll go back to Genesis and fill in the pieces here. In verse 13, for Adam was first formed, then Eve, and Adam was not deceived, but the woman being deceived was in transgression. Well, if Adam was not deceived, then he had to purposely partake of the fruit also to put himself on the same spiritual level as Eve was, and that was a sinner. So, in order to do that, for the human race to continue on. Now, if Adam had not partaken of the fruit, then he could have taken of the tree of life, which is mentioned in Genesis chapter 3. And there, in verse 21, we find out, if he would have taken of the tree of life and eat, that he could live forever. So we have Eve, who has the death sentence upon her, because God had said, the day that thou eatest, thou shalt surely die. So if they would have went ahead and had children in that kind of spiritual condition, then we find out that what would you have born? Would you have a child born with an old sin nature of Eve, or would you have it born with a nature of innocence of which Adam was? Now remember this, Adam and Eve had a nature as no other person has ever had. Innocence is sinlessness that has never faced trial. That was the condition that Adam was in. But righteousness is innocence that has been tested and found victorious. Now, being tested here by Adam, he was still in innocence, and we're going to find out that he partook of that so he could be on the same spiritual level as Eve, so that when God slew the animals, and therefore to make a covering of skins, which was a type of the blood that later on, 4,000 years later, would be shed upon the cross of Calvary, it would cover both of them. Now, we come here to verse 14, and we find out here at verse 15 of 1 Timothy chapter 2, and it's a very interesting verse, but it does fill in a lot of blanks back here in the book of Genesis. It says, notwithstanding she, that's Eve, shall be saved in childbearing, if they continue in faith and charity and holiness with sobriety. Now, let me point this out. Again, let's read it carefully. Notwithstanding, she shall be saved. The word in there is the Greek word that can be translated. It is dia, D-I-A, and meaning through childbearing. She shall be saved. She shall be saved alive. It's speaking about physical life now, not spiritual life. She shall be saved in childbearing or through childbearing. God will allow her to go on and have children if, now circle that little word if there, if they continue, and the word continue means abide in faith. Now, in order to abide in faith, you've got to have a starting point of faith. And that faith is, will Adam and Eve accept the skins and the clothing that God is going to give them, because he had rejected their fig leaves, which picture their own righteousness to cover their own sin. So God rejected that, and God was going to shed the blood of the animal so that he could get the skins in type now and literally clothe Adam and Eve. They're showing they must have faith in God's covering by the blood and not their own with the fig leaves of their own righteousness. Now, if they do that in faith, trusting that God knew best, trusting in faith that God rejected their fig leaves of self-righteousness, trusting in faith that the blood that was shed would be the covering that God would give, and it represented his righteousness, pointing 4,000 years later to the cross, when it would be the righteousness of Jesus Christ, another, to pay for the sins of the unrighteous, which is all humanity. Now, we continue on. In faith and charity. Now, the word charity there is the Greek word agape, agape love. That's the love of God. That's the love that a lost person cannot have. In the Greek, there is eros, which is a sexual love. Eros was a god, and the goddess was Aphrodite. And both the worship of both of them involved sex. God never used that Greek word in the New Testament at all, in the Greek New Testament. We find out there's another Greek word, which is philio. Philio is a word that has to do with brotherly love and so forth. But here, when we have agape love, that's the love that only we can have that God gives us. And that love is in the Holy Spirit. Now, in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit came and left and came and left. But therefore, after the cross of Calvary, it indwelt every person continually. So the same Holy Spirit worked from the time of creation here as it was working there when the Spirit brooded over the earth in Genesis chapter 1. The Holy Spirit always working. Always, always working. So we find out working in Adam and Eve that with that agape love and holiness, that holiness is translated in the Revised Version, sanctification, and holiness and sanctification are of the same Greek word, and it literally means set apart. And with the love of God and set apart with sobriety, that means sound judgment. So, we're going to start at the starting point here because there's not going to be any life continue on unless Adam and Eve accept the skin coverings that God had clothed them with after rejecting their fig leaves of self-righteousness. Now, let's go on back here to Genesis chapter 3. With that little bit of information here, it ties in perfectly and supplements here what we do not have given in Genesis chapter 3, all right? Now, we come on down here and we begin to look where the Lord here had clothed them, all right, where he had clothed them himself. Now, let's begin to look, and we'll come on down to, let's see here. And notice in verse 21, and unto Adam also and his wife did the Lord make skins, coats of skins, and clothed them. Now, God couldn't have clothed them with the skins where the blood had to be shed unless they accepted that. But through the conviction of the Holy Spirit, and the love now, or the charity spoken of in verse 10, that's agape love, they did love God. And God had asked them, you know, and talked to Adam about eating of the fruit and so forth there. Adam purposely partook of the fruit so he could be on the same fallen plane as Eve was, so the human race could continue. Now, let's look at this verse again. Unto Adam also and to his wife did the Lord make skins, coats of skins, and clothe them. Now, if they had refused, if Adam and Eve had refused to accept the righteousness of God pictured in the skins with the blood being shed, then the human race would never have continued on. What God would have done then, whether he would have created another Adam and Eve, we do not know. But the human race would not have continued. And the reason the human race would not have continued, and remember what God said in 1 Timothy chapter 2. Remember what he said? He said, if you will continue. If you will continue. Because first of all, why did he say if? Well, if you have two lost people that hated God, rejected his righteousness, and were going on in their own self-righteousness with the fig leaves, rejected the blood being shed, then if they would have had children, all of the children in human race from there on would have had no parents to teach them about the blood sacrifice and the promise of the coming Messiah. So you would have started out with two absolutely heathen that rejected God, didn't love God, wanted nothing to do with God, and God said, I will not continue the human race. You will not be saved in childbearing. You will die, the child will die, and the human race will stop right there. So it all hinged upon whether Adam and Eve would allow God to clothe them with his righteousness so that they would tell their children about the righteousness of God and that you cannot have eternal life by an offering that is, unless it is made by the blood. Now, we're going to see that in Cain and Abel as we get into the next chapter. So that's the reason that it was so important, and that's the reason that God said in verse 15 of 1 Timothy chapter 2, notwithstanding, she shall be saved. Now, that's physically, saved physically, in childbearing, if they continue, or the word continue means abide, in faith and agape love, that is the love of God, and holiness, that is, and set apart with sobriety, with sound judgment. Sound judgment means that they are going to tell their children that they have about the blood sacrifice pointing to the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, since they allowed God to clothe them with the righteousness of the skins pictured in the blood now. The blood had to be shed. Hebrews tells us without the shedding of blood there is no remission. Therefore, their sins were covered by the blood pictured in the skins of the animals, and therefore God would keep his promise, since they did that, that he would continue human life with them, and now he has two redeemed people, Adam and Eve, that will pass on to their children about the blood sacrifice and what God will accept. Now, if they had been heathens and rejected that, God would not have permitted the human race to go on, but would have devised some other plan, either to create another Adam and Eve, or whatever he might have done, we're not told. But the human race would not have went on. She would not have been saved in childbearing. She would have died, the child would have died, and Adam would have died. God wanted Christian parents to tell their children about what God had done and what he was going to do, which would only be through the blood sacrifice. Now, let's go back up to verse 15, because after Adam and Eve had sinned, the Lord had made a promise, and he promised, this is the first promise of the Messiah. Although a lot of the details are not given, yet we do know this is speaking of the first prophecy of Jesus Christ, some 4,000 years to come yet, that he would come and he would die. But God said also in verse 15, he said, this is going to be the warfare which has continued for the last 6,000 years. Notice here, if you will, in verse 15, and I will put enmity. Now, enmity in the Hebrew is warfare between thee and the woman, that is Satan and the woman. In verse 14, he talks about the serpent. And the Lord said unto the serpent, that describes his character, he's not a snake crawling on the ground. He's not some sort of animal walking around talking. He is Satan and the serpent, just like the old dragon. He's not a dragon. He is, and that describes his character, and God uses that. Now, I will put enmity, that's warfare, between thee, that's you, Satan, and the woman, and between thy seed, that's the demons and every wicked person that follows Satan, and her seed, and it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Her seed. Her seed was to produce the Lord Jesus Christ, clear up until Mary there, when Mary provided the body, a sinless body, for the Lord Jesus by the conception of the Holy Spirit, by the power of the Holy Spirit. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Now, in the long-range plan, bruising the head of Satan, it is the death stroke. That death stroke will not take place until the Lord casts Satan into the lake of fire, which he will. We find out in the permanent fulfillment of this is found in Revelation chapter 20, verse 10, where Satan is cast into the lake of fire along with the beast and the false prophet. But until that time, there's going to be enmity, there's going to be warfare. In Galatians 5:17, Paul described this in the Christian's life, because we have now the old sinful nature of Adam and Eve. And he says, for the flesh lusteth against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary one to another. So the Christian in their life, indwelt with the Holy Spirit of God, has a tremendous battle going on all through their life. And it will not be over until we receive our glorified bodies or our resurrected bodies, where the old nature will be gone forever from that time on. So we come on down and begin to find, it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Now, one man said, the heel of Christ, no wonder it's bruised, because every time Satan raises his ugly head, the Lord steps on it. And if you stepped on Satan's head and activities as many times as Christ did, your heel would be bruised too. Well, we find out that Satan does raise his ugly head. This warfare has continued on, and it is Satan always trying to substitute something to make you feel religious that is contrary to the Bible. And when it comes to salvation, he will substitute anything that will make you feel religious and make you feel good, but it will be without the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Without the blood, there is no salvation. We find in Ephesians 1:7, in whom we have redemption through his blood, Christ's blood, even the forgiveness of sins. Satan will tell you, let me baptize your baby. And I'll baptize your baby, and that will put him into the body of Christ. That's a satanic lie, backed by Satan, makes you feel good, and we have many mothers that run to the preacher and run to the church to have their baby baptized, but nowhere in the Bible did God ever say anything about babies being baptized, because they automatically go to heaven. But Satan loves to be religious, and he loves for preachers to be religious. He loves for churches to put on programs that are religious, but they are not in the Word of God. In Proverbs chapter 30, in verse 6, the Word of God says this, add thou not unto his words, lest he reprove thee, and thou be found a liar. I was talking to a man, and he goes to a church where the babies are to be baptized, and I asked him, I said, will you go to your preacher and find one verse anywhere where babies are to be baptized? He didn't want to talk about it. He didn't want to speak about it. He just wanted to argue about something else. But it's not there. Now, who devised that? Let me tell you point blank who devised it. Anything that is not in the Bible, devised by organized religion or anybody else, will always be without the blood. Babies being baptized by the water is not the blood. And it's actually an attack upon God. That God would send that baby to hell unless it was baptized. So when we bring our baby to have it baptized, it seems so religious, it seems so good, and it just seems like, well, now I'm safe now. No, you're not safe. You've been deceived. Satan has deceived you through his ministers. He's deceived you through your church. Because God said, don't add anything to what I have written in the Bible. And this is exactly what happens when you have babies baptized. It does nothing for the baby, but to you it seems religious and so forth, but it really is satanic. Nothing in the Bible. And if it's not in the Bible, God says, don't add unto the words that I have written, lest I reprove thee and thou be found a liar. When will that take place? Number one, it'll take place when you look in your Bible and find it's not there. Number two, it'll take place when those preachers and churches stand before God Almighty and he says, what in the world did you do to devise such a plan that I never put in the Bible? What did you do? Why did you make this up? And you don't need to. Why don't you teach the Bible? Why don't you teach my word? Why are you making these things up? You're really attacking me. You're leading people to believe if their baby's not baptized, then the baby's going to hell. And I never said anything like that. I'm speaking from God's viewpoint now. I never said anything like that at all, so you really lied about me. You're saying that I will send a baby to hell if it's not baptized. I never said that in the Bible. It's not in the Bible. In fact, we find just the opposite. Because in Luke 18, he said, bring these infants unto me, for such is the kingdom of God. Had they died right then, they would have went to heaven. David, when he lost his son through Bathsheba, said, I can't bring him back, but I can go to be with him. Not in hell, but in paradise. Maybe he had never been baptized. Whatsoever. So you're either preaching by the power of the Holy Spirit or you're preaching by the deception of Satan himself. And as he says in 2 Corinthians, his ministers appear to be the ministers of righteousness, but they're nothing more than satanic teachers. So you come back to the blood again. And the blood is what is shed to have remission for sins, and that truth is followed all the way through the Bible. Now we come on down and begin to see. Notice here, if you will, in verse 22, and the Lord God said, behold, the man has become as one of us to know good and evil, and now, lest he put forth his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat and live forever. Now, you know, it's a very interesting thing when the two trees are mentioned. If we go back here to verse 9 of the second chapter of Genesis. And out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to thy sight, for good and for food. The tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Now, God never put a prohibition upon the tree of life. But now, they could have eaten of it. But if they would have eaten of it, it evidently is and could be the same tree that's spoken of in Revelation chapter 22. We should say transplanted up into heaven by the river up there that yields its fruit once a month for 12 months of the year. And where you can eat and enjoy that fruit and live forever. You see, it's for those who are living forever that have everlasting life. But it's a very interesting thing. Evidently, Adam and Eve had not eaten of that tree, but if they had, they would have went on and lived forever. But now God said, the day that thou eatest of the tree of knowledge and good and evil, thou shalt surely die. So we come here and find out that God puts them out of the garden of paradise, which he had created and originally wanted them to have. He puts them out of there and guards that tree so they can't go back and eat, because something or somehow that we don't understand. But if they had eaten and go back and eat of the tree of life, they would have lived forever. But now notice here, and it must have been whatever it must have been absolutely delicious and what they could have really enjoyed. But now notice here, in verse 23, therefore the Lord God sent him forth from the garden of Eden to till the ground from whence he was taken. So he drove out the man, and he placed at the east of the garden of Eden cherubims with a flaming sword, which turned every way to keep the way of the tree of life. He would not take any chances of Adam and Eve going back into the paradise that God had created and put them in. And so he set that so they would not go back and eat of the tree of life, live on forever. They are now under the condemnation as far as experiencing the wages of sin, because they both had sinned. But thank God for the appropriation here of the skins which the blood had to be shed in order to make an atonement for their sins, and they accepted that. And that's why the human race continued on. It would not have, if Adam and Eve had rejected the blood sacrifice. That would have stopped the human race then, because only if they continue in charity and holiness, which is being set apart, and sobriety and sound mind, would God allow the human race to continue, where he knew the parents, Adam and Eve, the first parents, would teach their offspring about the blood sacrifice. Now, with that in mind, let's go on here as we continue here about the blood sacrifice and find out again the conflict between religion and Christianity. We come over here to Genesis chapter 4. Now, this is going to be interesting as we go through here, because the same thing applies today. You have exactly the same thing today as you have in Cain and Abel. Exactly. Cain was the one who wanted to bring a sacrifice. Now, he was religious. He wanted to bring a sacrifice to God, and he did. Abel also brought a sacrifice to God, and God accepted the sacrifice of Abel, but he rejected the sacrifice of Cain. Now, in order for Abel to bring the right sacrifice, Adam and Eve fulfilled by accepting the blood sacrifice and the skins, pointing to the cross of Calvary, when the seed of the woman shall bruise the head of the seed of the serpent, prophesied clear back in Genesis 3:15, pointing 4,000 years later, when Christ would die upon the cross, they would continue, which they did, by teaching their offspring about the blood sacrifice. No doubt, they related all of the incidents that took place in the garden. They related what God has said to them in the garden, thou shalt not eat, therefore, of the tree of knowledge and good and evil. No particular reason other than God was testing them to see whether they were going to obey or disobey. So we come here to Genesis chapter 4, and we're continuing with the human race now, and Adam and Eve teaching both of their children now about the blood sacrifice. Now notice, and in verse 1, Adam knew his wife, knew Eve his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I have begotten a man from the Lord. Now that promise that God had made in Genesis 3:15, she was looking for the Messiah right then. from the Lord is Kenathai Jehovah in the Hebrew, and it means begotten a man, even the Lord. She looked for the promise that God had given to her right then in Genesis chapter 3, look for him in the firstborn as even being the Messiah. Of course, she did not know the plan of God, that it was going to go on for thousands of years yet, and another 4,000 approximately, then the Messiah would come, and Mary would have the privilege of providing the body for the Lord Jesus to dwell in and to go to the cross, God himself in human flesh. And again she bare his brother Abel, and Abel was a keeper of sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. And in the process of time it came to pass that Cain brought of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord. And in verse 4, Abel he also brought of the firstlings of his flock, and of the fat thereof, and the Lord had respect unto Abel and to his offering. But I want to back up to verse 3 here, because we find out in the process of time it came to pass that Cain brought of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord. So he believed in the Lord, his parents had told him about the Lord, but his parents had also told him that God will not accept anything that grows out of the ground. Anything that you can produce yourself, nothing will God accept, except the blood sacrifice. Now Cain refused that. He wanted to bring to the Lord something he could do out of his pride, and something he could produce, and say, Lord, accept me now. Look what I've brought you. You've got to accept me because of what I have done. This is exactly what's pictured in religion today. Religion is a hater of Christianity. Religion is not a friend of grace, but it's a friend of works. And it's works centered in yourself, of something you do, whether it be your church membership, your water baptism, whatever it might be, or your good works, but it will always be centered in you trying to reach heaven by what you do instead of what Christ did for you on the cross. Not by works of righteousness which we've done, but according to his mercy as he saved us. So with that, our time's gone, and we just want to ask you, have you trusted Jesus Christ? Or are you trusting your baptism, your church membership, your good works? None of that pictured in Cain will ever get you to heaven. But God said he loved the world and gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him, not bring your good works of Cain, but believeth in him, that's Christ, who did the good work by his blood sacrifice, so that you could have eternal life. I hope if you've never received Christ, you'll do it now. We hope that you'll take time to write us. Our mailing address is the Heritage Radio Bible Class, Post Office Box 573, Walnut Grove, Minnesota, and our zip code is 56180. Until next week at this same time, may the Lord richly bless you as we ever pray. Even so, come, Lord Jesus.